black paintings. Pinturas Negras is a name given to a group of 14 paintings by Francisco Goya from the later part of his life, likely between 1819 and 1823. They portray intense, haunting themes reflective of both his fear of insanity and his bleak outlook on humanity. In 1819, at the age of 72, Goya moved into a two-story house outside Madrid that was called Quinta del Zurdo, Deaf Man's Villa. Although the house had been named after the previous owner, who was deaf, Goya, too, was nearly deaf at the time as a result of an illness that he suffered when he was 46. The paintings originally were painted as murals on the walls of the house, later being hacked off the walls and attached to the canvas. They are now in the Museo del Prado in Madrid. After the Napoleonic Wars and the internal turmoil of the changing Spanish government, Goya developed an embittered attitude toward mankind. He had a first-hand and acute awareness of panic, terror, fear, and hysteria. He had survived two near-fatal illnesses and grew increasingly anxious and impatient in fear of relapse. The combination of these factors is thought to have led to his production of the black paintings, using oil paints and working directly on the walls of his dining and sitting rooms. Goya created works with dark, disturbing themes. The paintings were not commissioned and were not meant to leave his home. It is likely that the artist never intended the works for public exhibition. These paintings are as close to being hermetically private as any that have ever been produced in the history of Western art. Two men fighting with cudgels. Two men are battling each other with cudgels. Both are standing up to their knees in sand so that neither can run away, and it remains unclear whether even the victor will be able to extricate himself. There is no spectator in sight. Bloody madness in a bleak landscape. Men Reading shows a group of six men huddled together reading a printed page held in the lap of a seated central figure. Although it is not known for certain, they are often thought to be politicians reading and passing comments on a newspaper article about themselves. Goya most likely placed the work on a smaller wall of the first floor of the Quinto next to its companion piece, Women Laughing, and opposite, The Dog, and Two Men Eating Soup. Fantastic visions. Two figures, one male and one female, are shown airborne, hovering above a broad landscape. The woman wears a white dress covered by a red rose-colored robe. Both seem fearful. She covers the lower half of her face with her robe. His face is deeply disturbed. They are each looking in opposite directions, while he points to a town on the top of a mountain on the right of the canvas. Critic Evan Connell notes that the mountain's shape resembles Gibraltar, a refuge for Spanish liberals during the aftermath of the Peninsular War. In the foreground, a row of French soldiers resembling those from Goya's The 3rd of May, 1808, take aim at a group of people passing the lower distance. This group is traveling with horses and wagons and are perhaps refugees fleeing from the earlier war with France, the victims of whom Goya had detailed so closely in his The Disasters of War. The Dog. The painting is divided into two unequal sections, an upper dirty ochre sky and a smaller sloping curved dark brown section which fades to black as it slopes up and to the right. Over the top of this lower section, the dog's head can be seen, its snout lifted, its ears pulled back, and its eyes looking up and towards the right. A faint dark shape looms over the dog. This is sometimes considered to be damage or an intentional inclusion, but it is generally seen as an artifact from the earlier painting that decorated the wall before Goya overpainted it with the dog. The enigmatic depiction of the dog has led to myriad interpretations of Goya's intentions. The painting is often seen as a symbolic depiction of a man's futile struggle against malevolent forces. The black sloping mass which envelops the dog is imagined to be quicksand, earth, or some other material in which the dog has become buried. Having struggled unsuccessfully to free itself, it can now do nothing but look skywards, hoping for a divine intervention that will never come. The vast swath of sky, which makes up the bulk of the picture, intensifies the feeling of the dog's isolation and hopelessness of its situation. Others see the dog as cautiously raising his head above the black mass, afraid of something outside the painting's field of view, or perhaps an image of abandonment, loneliness, and neglect. Robert Hughes says, "We do not know what it means, but its pathos moves us on a level below narrative." The Fates. The painting is a reinterpretation of the mythological subject of the goddess of destiny, the Moirai, or Fates, as recounted in Homer, Hesiod, Virgil, and other classical writers. These daughters of the night were headed by Atropos, the inexorable goddess of death who carries a few scissors to cut the thread of life, Clotho, with her distaff, which Goya replaces with a doll or newborn child, which possibly an allegory for life, and Lachesis, the spinning one, which in this representation looks across the lens or in the mirror and symbolizes time, since she was the one who measured the length of the fiber. To the three female figures suspended in the air, a fourth figure is added in the foreground. Possibly male, this figure's hands are bound behind him as if he is captive. If this interpretation is true, the Fates would be deciding the destiny of the man whose hands cannot be opposed to his fate. It has been speculated that he may represent Prometheus, who was bound on a mountain and left to be savaged by an eagle as punishment for stealing fire from Mount Olympus. All four are hideously ugly. Leocadia. The picture probably depicts Leocadia Weiss, the artist's maid, younger by 35 years and distant relative, though this identity has been contested. As with any of the paintings from the series, the current title was not Goya's own, and he never mentioned or wrote about any of the black paintings. Leocadia was probably similar in features to Goya's first wife, Josefa Bayou, to the extent that one of his well-known portraits bears the cautious title of Josefa Bayou, or Leocadia Weiss. The painting's funeral air is established through the shading of the gray background, the coloring of the model's black veil and maha dress, and her sad or nostalgic expression. She is positioned before an open blue sky, with her body slightly leaning against a rock or mound. The mound is topped by a row of small or wrought iron rails. Some critics have suggested it may represent a burial mound. The painting contains a sense of peace and air of reconciliation, absent in the other works from the series. Writer Juan José Guiñera wrote that the work may represent a personification of melancholy, or given the relationship between the artist and model, the symbol, the fire of love, and of the home, and the presentiment of coming death. While Cunera describes the identification of Leocadia as more romantic than certainty, the work bears strong resemblance to a Goya portrait more or less accepted to be of her, and which was left in her possession following his death. according to Robert Havard, her confident stare and Maha dress may be indications of the earlier charge against her adultery. A pilgrimage to San Isidro. A pilgrimage to San Isidro shows a view of the pilgrimage towards San Isidro's hermitage of Madrid that is totally opposite to Goya's treatment of the same subject 30 years earlier, in the meadow of San Isidro. If the earlier work was a question of depicting the customs of a traditional holiday in Madrid and providing a reasonably accurate view of the city, the present painting depicts a group of prominent figures in the night, apparently intoxicated and singing with distorted voices. Diverse social strata also figure in the painting. In the foreground, a group of humble extraction appears, while further into the background, top hats and nuns' habits can be seen. Procession of the Holy Office. Pilgrimage depicts a procession headed by a group of eight more discernible people. One man wears clothing from the 17th century and carries a glass. Another is a monk or a nun. The left half of the painting with its bright sky is among the wider passages of the black paintings, which are dominated by browns, grays, and blacks. Another black painting, A Pilgrimage to San Isidro, seems a piece similar to Pilgrimage, except for its darker tone. Both may depict expressions to the shrine of San Isidro, a thought reflected in their titles, none given by Goya, which was close to his home, Quinta del Sulfo. Judith in the Holofernes. The picture is a personal reinterpretation of the narrative of the Book of Judith, in which the protagonist saves Israel from the assault of the general Holofernes by seducing and beheading him. Judith is the only historical figure who can be identified with certainty among the black paintings. Judith in the Holofernes palette consists of blacks, ochres, and red applied with very free, broad, and energetic brushstrokes. The lighting is both focused and highly theatrical, and seems to imply a night scene lit by a torch, which illuminates Judith's face. An outstretched arm leaves in semi-darkness the face of the old serving woman, whose darkened outline is shown in prayer. Significantly, neither Holofernes nor the blood streaming from his neck is shown, and is typical of most artistic renderings. Given Goya's bitter disillusionment over the second restoration of Fernando VII, it is possible that Holofernes represents the Spanish king, who Goya privately despised. Holofernes' death was often depicted in art as a symbol of the defeat of tyranny. This would have been a brave and daring illusion for an artist with such ties to the crown as Goya had. For Goya did not believe, however, that the series would ever be viewed by anyone but himself, which allowed him greater freedom of expression. He had been secretive before when delivering unpalatable political views through his work. His The Disasters of War series of etchings harshly comments on both the Peninsular War and the later Bourbon Restoration, but was only published 35 years after his death. Saturn devouring his son. A disturbing portrait of the Titan Saturn consuming one of his children, was one of six works with which Goya decorated the dining room. According to Roman myth, inspired by the original Greek myth, it had been foretold that one of the sons of Saturn would overthrow him, just as he had overthrown his father, Cleus. To prevent this, Saturn ate his children moments after each was born. His wife, Ops, eventually hid his third son, Jupiter, on the island of Crete, deceiving Saturn by offering a stone wrapped in swaddling in his place. Jupiter eventually supplanted his father, just as the prophecy predicted. Goya depicts Saturn feasting upon one of his sons. His child's head and part of the left arm have already been consumed. The right arm has possibly been eaten too, though it could be folded in front of the body and held in place by Saturn's thumbs. He's on the point of taking another bite from the left arm. As he looms from the darkness, his mouth gapes, and his eyes bulge widely. The only other brightness in the picture comes from the white flesh, the red blood of the corpse, the white knuckles of Saturn as he digs his fingers into the back of the body. There is evidence that the picture may have originally portrayed the Titan with a partial erect penis. But, if ever present, this addition was lost due to deterioration of the mural over time or during the transfer to canvas. In the picture today, the area around the groin is indistinct. It may have been overpainted deliberately before the picture was put on public display. Various interpretations of the meaning of the picture have been offered. The conflict between youth and old age. Time as a devourer of all things. The wrath of God. And an allegory of the situation in Spain, where the fatherland consumed its own children in wars and revolution. There have been explanations rooted in Goya's relationships with his own son, Xavier, the only of his six children to survive to adulthood, or with his live-in housekeeper and possible mistress, Leocadia Weiss. Witch's Sabbath. Satan preaches from a raised earth mound and is dressed in clerical clothing that may be a soutane. He has a goat-like beard and horns and stands in silhouette, accentuating his heavy body and gaping mouth, which is depicted as if he is screaming. He holds court before a circle of crouched and mostly terrified women, accepted by art historians as a coven of witches. Some bow their heads in fear. Others look towards him in open mouth and rapt awe. Describing the women, art historian Brian McWade writes that the subhumanity of the gathered group is underlined by their bestial features and moronic stares. Satan's absolute power over the women has been compared to that of the king in Goya's 1815, the Junta of the Philippines, where authority is gained not from respect or personal charisma, but through fear and domination. The women are a mixture of old and young, and have similar twisted features. All but one are scowling, nervous, and obsequious. An old woman sits to the right of the goat, her back to the viewer. Her face is half hidden, and she wears a white hooded headdress resembling a nun's habit. She sits alongside bottles and vials on the ground to her right. Art critic Robert Hughes wonders if they contain drugs and filters needed for the devilish ceremonies. The eyes of some figures are lined with white paint. The faces of the two figures The goat and the woman to the far right are hidden. The woman is separated from the group. She is perhaps a postulant about to be initiated into the coven. She may represent Goya's maid and probable lover, Leocadia Weiss, whose full-length portrait appears in the same series. Women laughing. The work shows three figures, generally thought to be two witch-like women and one man, huddled together against a black background and lit from the left. The intended meaning of the work is highly obscure. The background is devoid of setting or detail, and no context is given as to who these people might be, what they are captured doing, or where the scene is set. The figure at right, facing the viewer, is generally presumed to be male. His hands are around his crotch. He appears to be either masturbating, exposing himself, or simply intellectually disabled. According to art critic Fred Licht, the sickly grin of his face certainly seems indicative of some sort of sexual compulsion. The two women are likely prostitutes, and leer with mocking expression and broad, sinister smiles, seemingly ignoring the male figure. Some critics have speculated that the lower, concealed portion of the canvas hides the fact that the woman on the far left is also masturbating. Support for this view draws from the strange smiles and expressions on both women's faces, which are equally grotesque as the man's. According to Licht, they may be an element of self-mockery in this painting, some equation between the ironic loneliness of the exhibitionist, whose aim of attracting people is constantly thwarted by the means he obsessively adopts to capture the attention, and the artist, who also bears himself without shame or restraint, and who is also doomed to being railed at as an aberration. Two old men. In the picture, two elderly figures dressed in friar's habits stand before a black background. The man in front has a long gray beard, is tall and rests on a cane. He may represent Kronos, the god of time. Beside him is a highly caricatured figure whose face is animal-like. This figure seems to be shouting into the ear of his companion, which might be an allusion to Goya's deafness. There is a noticeable difference between the treatment of the two figures, calmly resting on his walking stick, with a sad but serene expression. The bearded man recalls the philosophers depicted in Velázquez, which had been copied by Goya. In vivid contrast, the features of his monstrous companion recall the friars depicted by Goya in his Caprichos and Disparates. Two old ones eating soup. In the image, two elderly figures loom forward from a black background. Although they are assumed to be men, their gender is not readily apparent. The mouth of the left figure is drawn into a grimace, possibly from lack of teeth. In stark contrast to this animated expression, the face of the other figure hardly seems alive at all. The eyes are black hollows, and the head in general bears the aspect of a skull. As in the rest of the black paintings, Goya's use of his medium displays an assurance that comes only from a lifetime of experience. Paint is handled freely and rapidly, yet with great decisiveness. The palette knife is also used to apply paint in some areas. Black, ochres, earth tones, and grays are the only colors used, as in the rest of the black paintings.